begin to fall.
WKCR FM, New York. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Traditions in Swing, a Saturday jazz show here on radio station WKCR-FM New York, 89.9 on the dial. You know, it's been a rough week for many of us here in the jazz world, in particular for yours truly, Phil Schaap. Among other things, I've been ill the past few days, but we've been keeping on the programs. And, of course, earlier this week, the beginning of several days of sadness with the passing of Roy Eldridge. Nevertheless, I can advise you that there's a celebratory mood right in this room because we've got a visitor today, and our whole program will be on the music and the person, Stan Getz, who's here at WKCR-FM New York. We're going to do a live interview. We're going to feature his forthcoming release. We're going to touch base with some of the key players and recordings that he's done over the years. And we're going to get a chance to talk with someone we've always listened to. Stan Getz, that's our focus, Traditions and Swing, this Saturday, the 4th of March, 1989, on WKCR-FM New York. And welcome, Stan Getz. Thank you. We just heard Billy's Bounce, one of the most famous of Charlie Parker's blues, a bebop line that was first done in the studio in November of 45 with Miles Davis, Dizzy on piano, Curly Russell, Max Roach, and Bird. We heard it with a two-horn front line, but there was a decided difference. There was a trombone for the brass. It was J.J. Johnson on trombone, and for the saxophone, it was a tenor played by the one and only Stan Getz. They also had four-piece rhythm section. Believe me, the pianist was not a trumpeter doing some sideline work. It was the great Oscar Peterson with Herb Ellis on guitar, Ray Brown on bass, and Connie Kay on drums. And that was J.J. and Stan at the Opera House. The concerts in stereo were given at the Chicago Civic Opera House, and that's why all these albums were called at the Opera House. The mono concerts actually were done at the Shrine Auditorium in Los Angeles, and just to make it a more complex ball of numbers, the dates on them have always been wrong. It was Sunday night, September 29th, 1957 for Chicago, and Monday night, October 7th, 1957.
And wait a minute, what's wrong with your memory?
I'll tell you how I found out the dates. I checked in with the microfilm, that's all. Just went to the public library, checked out the newspaper, looked up the advertisements, and the dates were quite clear.
That's very encyclopedic.
Well, I'm something of a weirdo in that fashion. We're talking here with Stan Getz, and we just heard some of your most famous recordings in this fashion that J.J. Johnson, who is of your generation, is considered preeminent of the bebop years on trombone. And you had sort of formed a group within the context of the touring jam session of Jazz at the Philharmonic for the 57 years. And, of course, with the blessing of the mono recordings and the stereo recordings, even though they were under the same label, we actually get two concerts, which have now been coupled on the CD issue. Any recollections or musical insights you'd like to offer about the trombone tenor tandem?
Well, even though they're both in the same register, it didn't matter because the excitement of playing in front of Oscar Peterson and Ray Brown and Herb Ellis and Connie Kay and with J.J. was just fun every night of that tour. That was the actual concert both times. Both played in front of about 7,000 people each time. And it was just a joy. Those were some good old days, as we say. And you had to be on your toes.
Well, I'm going to try to be on my toes this evening because this is one of the great old days in KCR's lore, even though it's happening live right now. But they'll always be talking about this Saturday evening here, this 4th of March of 1989, when Stan Getz came in with friends and sort of camped out at the home of technical difficulties with both its new and old ceiling side by side here in the room. And I'm so pleased to have you here at the station to chat about these various jazz topics. And you brought us some cassettes. I got you some special music here, so I think we're going to have a good time.
You have something you say that I don't even know that I did with Roy Eldridge.
I believe so.
I can't remember doing it. I'd love to hear it.
Well, this gets, you know, part of the Jazz at the Philharmonic tour of 57 used to end up the first half with a jam session, usually on Stuffy, where the other group within the tour, Roy and Coleman Hawkins, plus you and J.J. would make four horns and go to town on Stuffy. I actually have some rare ones of that, although I didn't bring them with me. And the following year's tour, apparently Norman Granz had you fellas record some of the tunes, which served as the soundtrack. Now, I have the recordings, so you don't hear the dialogue, but of a movie that was called Les Trois Chères. I'll spell it because my French is non-existent, or virtually non-existent. T-R-I-C-H-E-U-R-S.
The Very Dear.
Well, the very dear, perhaps. I think share, dear in French is C-H-E-R-E. But in any case, let's find out how dear
share,
it is.
How did you spell it?
C-H-E-U-R-S.
Sure, I don't know what that means.
But I do know that there's some there's music here. Well, maybe, this station and indeed all of New York City, and I imagine the jazz world has been very caught up in the recent sad news of the death on Sunday, the 26th, of Roy Eldridge.
What a fiery trumpet player.
Let's hear Stan Getz talk about Roy Eldridge. Why don't you tell us about
him? Well, Roy traveled with a bottle of hot sauce in his trumpet case. And he mostly didn't like any of the food that was served in all these restaurants we ate all over the world. And he always had his bottle of hot sauce to put on it. As far as musically, he was absolutely, if not the most, one of the most exciting trumpet players or any kind of horn player that I ever heard. And when I traveled 2 years with him on the Jazz at the Philharmonic, and it's unbelievable how exciting, fiery he played.
Stan Getz talking about Roy Eldridge. Before we play some of this JTP, a couple of other questions related to that topic. There are a few figures. Now, Jazz at the Philharmonic rarely introduced somebody new to the public, although Oscar Peterson was, I guess, Norman Granz's biggest discovery that became this incredible career. Frequently, mainstream swing players were built in a larger and larger all-star cast. You know, you get a Buck Clayton, then you had a Roy Eldridge. You had all sorts of great figures. But there were some players who were considered, you know, stars and then left their own bands to become part of the touring Jazz at the Philharmonic. Three or four come to mind immediately. Ella Fitzgerald in the 40s, and then in the 50s, Gene Krupa, Dizzy Gillespie, and yourself. What about that transition? Were the four of you, or could you speak for just yourself? What did you think about making that transition and going into this road package?
Well, who would want to pass up a chance to play with, say, in the same saxophone section, Coleman Hawkins, Lester Young, Sonny Stitt, Eleanor Jacquette, Flip Phillips, and myself? I mean, that's a challenge. That's what we thrive on, is having our blood moving. And the rhythm and the trumpets, you know, Dizzy and Roy and JJ. I mean, it's a once-in-a-lifetime proposition. You don't turn something like that down. So, and I had to do it.
So you would say that, certainly for yourself, Stan Getz, that the transition from superstar with own band to superstar in the midst of this all-star package was an easy one to make and one you were quite fond of.
I loved it. It was great getting to know those guys, traveling with them. I'll never forget it. It was just too beautiful. Mm-hmm. And funny. We had a good time, even though we worked hard.
Okay. I mean, do you remember whose idea it was to put you and J.J. Johnson together in sort of like a group within the jam session?
Probably Norman.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And again, you think, although the trombone tenor is a similar register scene, that it made all the sense in the world to you?
Well, Norman had heard Bob Brookmeyer, who played on my band at the time. He heard us do it, so he figured, why not J.J., another trombone?
Mm-hmm. Okay, we're talking with Stan Getz, and we're sort of feeling out the atmosphere of those glorious sessions of the middle 50s when Stan Getz joined Jazz at the Philharmonic. Any particular musical evening that you'd like to remember, or some aspect or person within the session you'd like to speak of? Stan Getz, still on the topic of JATP.
About JATP?
Yeah.
Well, I can remember a story of the last night of a six-week tour. We were doing two concerts on one Sunday, one in Newark, New Jersey, and then we had to fly to Detroit. And at that time, they were landing at Willow Run Airport, which is the great big wartime airport where they built all those B-19s and B-17s, B-24s. It was a huge airport. The only trouble, it was a long distance from the metropolis of Detroit. And Norman would hire a bus from the airport. We were very tired. We'd already traveled to Newark that day, played a concert, and got on another plane, and we're headed to do the last concert. And we're all sitting there sort of half-dozing, waiting to get to the hotel, change into our tux, and do the last concert. And one of the saxophone players just had so much energy, he got up and started to play saxophone up and down the aisle of the bus. And he kept going past Lester Young's ear, playing the saxophone. Lester was sitting on the aisle. And nobody said anything. We let him do his thing, and we were just napping. Finally, he went up to Prez and nudged Prez and said, hey, first he played this very complicated riff. And he said, hey, Prez, what do you think of that? And Prez looked up with those sleepy eyes he had, you know, and his pork pie hat. And he said, yes, I know, but can you sing me a song? In other words, he was saying, can you stop playing all those notes and just play some sweet melodies? You know, and I remember that. I remember a lot of things, but can't tell the rest of them on the air.
Okay, we're talking with Stan Getz, and we are on the air. This is Traditions in Swing. It's live on this Saturday evening. Stan Getz is most graciously visiting our studios, and we're going to share memories and music and some insights with him in the course of this Traditions in Swing program. I'm Phil Schaap, and I'm overjoyed and, to a degree, overwhelmed to have the great Stan Getz here in the studio.
No, I hear that you're the man in New York. You're the only guy that plays our music, and I'm overjoyed at being here.
Well,
because we need a good station in New York, and right now you're it.
Thank you so much, Stan.
Well, and I wish you long life on this show, and I wish the show to go on forever.
Well, I'm very pleased, and I hope that means that we'll be able to do more than one show together someday. I'm going to take a stab then and throw in another question out, and this would sort of like to get Stan Getz's words on people that we're interested in. You called a roster of tenor saxophone players. I was wondering if I called their names, you could describe, say who they are, perhaps one or two phrases that would familiarize the listener with what they had done, what their sound and concept was about, and then we'll move on to the next one of this all-star tenor scene, still on the JATP bit. Let's start with Flip Phillips.
What do you want to know about Flip?
Well, how would you introduce Flip Phillips to our jazz audience to say who he was and what he did?
Flip Phillips was a great tenor man who played with the first Herd, Woody Herman's Herd, and played some very powerful saxophone. And he was of the Coleman Hawkins school, and he just is a wonderful saxophone player. He just got a new record out now where he plays bass clarinet, and he's still in there playing when he's not fishing in Pompano Beach, Florida, and he belonged there. We all had a lot of competitive spirit going in those days, and it was good for us.
Did the two of you ever compare the first Herd with the Four Brothers Herd that you were a part of?
Oh, we never compared them. No, we didn't speak about it. But I remember a story about Flip Phillips. He was such a baseball fan that we were on stage one night when it was the last game or something of a World Series. And he went out there to play his ballad number, and he had a little transistor radio in his pocket and one little earphone that you can't see that you stick into your phone. He was playing his ballad while listening to the game.
Well, you mentioned that Flip Phillips has added the bass clarinet to his lineup, a man who played many different saxophones but was featured on JATP with you as a tenorist is the one and only Sonny Stitt. How could you introduce Sonny to our audience?
Oh, I love Sonny Stitt. Sonny Stitt is my birthday buddy. We were born on the same day, and we were always close. We've been miserable together, and we've been gloriously happy together. He is one of the most proficient saxophonists that ever lived, and a great guy. And when he suddenly got cancer in Japan about 5 years ago, I was in touring in Europe, and I tried to get on. I was just about to get on a Concorde. I canceled the rest of my tour. No, not the rest of it, just a few nights to get to him in Washington, D.C. in the hospital. And I called my agent to check that I was going to be met and whisked off to the hospital. And he told me he had already passed, so I didn't go. But I love Sonny Stitt.
Oh, boy. Could you and somehow describe what the differences might be in his playing from tenor to the alto, which he played so often? What was stylistically different, or if anything?
Well, of course, there's the inevitable comparison between he and Bird on alto. You know, and all the other things, I don't think he was imitating that much. It was just his natural inclination to play that way. On tenor, is more robust, more, say, in the Dexter and Gene Ammons school. But he's one guy that could play the hell out of both saxophones.
Absolutely. You just heard Stan Getz talking first about Flip Phillips and then about Sonny Stitt. I'm sort of calling off a roster of tenor saxophone giants with whom he played with many years ago in jazz at the Philharmonic. The next name, I'm pleased to say, is a name that is still with us and has a big band these days, plus a teaching gig at Harvard, and that's Illinois Jacquet, or Illinois Jacquet, as the French would say, or Illinois Jacket, as Joe Jones would say if he was here. Stan Getz on the topic of Illinois.
Right, well, it's also from the Hawkins School, wouldn't you say?
Well, I think he's the generation that's the first generation that's young enough to start figuring out a way to combine elements of different styles.
Right. I think you're right. There's not much to say. He was his own man. He wore his own hat, and he played the way he wanted. And it could be terrifying to be on the same stage with him. You have to come up with it. I'll tell you, he was a great saxophone player.
On that first point you were making, I will say that the key route to me, to my ears, when listening to Illinois Jacket, is that the first tenor sound that caught his attention that he incorporates to this day is that of the Texas interpretation of Coleman Hawkins' playing, like Herschel Evans in the first Basie band.
Mm-hmm.
I think Herschel meant a lot to him, and that's sort of overlooked as an influence on him. In fact, you know, Flying Home, the famous one, that famous release, that's just a quote of Herschel Evans on Texas Shuffle.
Wa-da-di-da. Wa-da-da-di-da.
Well, that's the start.
That's also Martha, a semi-classical piece.
Well, that bridge, I'm not going to bother singing because it would be out of tune and everybody would be mad at me. But
well, anybody can sing in with me in the room because I'm out of tune, too. I got that whiskey baritone.
Well, any case, if you know the original Basie blue label Decca 78 of Texas Shuffle, in the middle of Dickie Wells' trombone chorus, Herschel pops in for 8 bars on the bridge, and that's a taste Illinois Jacquette's Flying Home.
Right.
Well, we got the blockbusters ahead, and we're now going to hear Stan Getz on the topic of Coleman Hawkins.
Well, he was the king. Prez was the prez, but he was the king. I mean, he really opened up the saxophone and made it really the solo instrument that it is, you know, and he was a very robust player. And funny thing about him, he could play in any milieu. He played with the older cats, the younger cats. He always looked ahead, and he got, when bebop came along, he was playing with JJ and all those guys and making bebop riffs on his records. And he was a master, and that's the only time I ever got to work with him, and I'll never forget it.
And finally, to one of the dominant sounds of our jazz world, the tone, sort of a lighter tone of the tenor saxophone from the man you just said was the president, as opposed to Hawkins the king, Lester
Young.
Well,
you know, I fear, or I should be happy, that my tendency in music is to lean towards classicism. And I'd always heard tenor players playing raunchy and dirty, and that was supposed to be jazz. But when I heard Lester Young, I heard true oral beauty on the saxophone, and his light tiptoeing way of playing saxophone appealed to me tremendously. Now, before I'd heard him, I'd worked a year with Jack Teagarden when I was 15, 16 years old, and I loved, he influenced me a lot. Jack Teagarden, trombone player,
yes.
One of the greats. Then I worked a year with Benny Goodman, who's another great master of a wind instrument, because it's all wind, no matter what horn it is. But so between those three guys, I think they had a lot to do with forming my conception of beauty. What's that saying? Beauty is?
For all the beauty there may be.
For all the beauty there may be in this world. And Prez was so beautiful. And he was that way as a person. He never would hurt a fly. Never had a bad thing to say about anybody.
And the stage whisper was from Judith Scher, and I might also point out that that concept of the woodwind for the tenor saxophone, and indeed for all the family of saxophone and other instruments, was a word that Prez would use. We were talking with Willie Jones, the drummer, with Monk and with Mingus, and of course with Lester Young just the other day, and he said that when Prez hired him, he said, "We have to have a conference," and this is the total sum of the conference. Willie, you see that in the chair? And it was Prez's tenor. He says, "That is a woodwind. You play titty boom, titty boom behind that. The other guy's playing a trumpet. I don't care what you do behind." And so there's Lester Young. And of course, he had a different interpretation of the way a tenor should sound. He came from an alto background and had a little bit of an airborne quality to his tone, but he, from what I'm told by his brother Lee and others, that he followed his own message to that other saxophonist on the bus, that he slowed down the pace when he switched from alto to tenor and played pretty, and notes that meant a lot, even if there weren't a large number of them.
Right.
We're talking about Lester Young with Stan Getz, and it's just an honor, as I say, to be hearing about these tenor players from one of the all-time tenor giants, Stan Getz. I guess I owe you some music. First of all, here's a record.
I'm dying to hear that record. I don't know if I ever made that record.
Okay, I've got a record here. Now, these are studio recordings that were utilized on a movie soundtrack made on May 1st of 1958 with a Oscar Peterson Trio plus drums. Gus Johnson's the drummer, if I'm not mistaken. It's Herb Ellis, Ray Brown, Oscar Peterson, and Stan's on tenor. We'll find out he's here. And Roy Eldridge is on trumpet. And I will say that I did play this for Roy in the hospital in the last week of his life. And he yelled out, Stan, on your entry. So that's one authority already spoken for. We'll hear from Stan Getz on the very same topic. Okay, well, we just played a very rare recording, and its rarity probably helps explain how one of the participants, Mr. Stan Getz on tenor saxophone, could have completely forgotten that he was ever on a soundtrack recording for an obscure French movie, which is spelled L-E-S, second word, T-R-I-C-H-E-U-R-S. But that was it, and indeed, I presume you're now agreeing with all of us that it was you and Roy Eldridge.
I confess. I'm guilty.
No recollections at all. It's just something that probably popped in the studio and that was that.
Oh, either that or Norman might have recorded it right on the job.
It's studio.
Studio?
It's studio. There are tones on it and everything. Any case, the tone that's being sounded on this Saturday evening is the tone of Stan Getz's voice visiting us here on Traditions in Swing. I'm Phil Schaap, and we're talking about a variety of topics, including some of the great people. And one of the things that I know a lot of jazz masters, and you certainly are a jazz master, who visit the station, and then you find someone like me who's got a head for facts and figures and starts asking you about things that happened a half century ago, particularly if I'm asking for small details about things that are long since forgotten, can get a little bit, let's talk about now. And indeed, one of the things I'm glad that you brought with you is that your forthcoming release is with us. But since you did bring up some of those earlier influences and those band experiences, I can't help but ask you to perhaps talk a little bit about the very young Stan Getz and the fact that you participated, partly because of that you were a precocious talent on the scene. You already had arrived in your early teens, but also there was the World War II thing, and there was a lot of openings for sub-draft age musicians, and you ended up playing in two of the biggest bands of all time.
That's right.
I'd like to ask you about each of them individually. First, how you met, what you remember about Jack Teagarden and playing in that band.
Well, I was lucky enough to play Dixieland first with Teagarden. And to me that was lucky because I believe a person should learn how to walk before he learns how to run. And Teagarden was truly one of the great masters in jazz. His trombone playing, I don't think to this day anybody could master the trombone like he mastered it. He was able to play a scale in the first three positions. And his hand never moved beyond those first three positions. If you notice, you'll see trombone players, they're just jerking their arm back and forth all seven positions. Somehow he had these fingerings where he could just, the wrist would just move ever so slightly, and his sound was big. One time, we played a theater in San Antonio, and we were sitting behind the soundtrack. In those days, there wasn't stereo, just a big speaker, huge speaker behind the screen. And then we were behind that, ready to go on with the stage show. And before we went on was a trailer for a movie in which Tommy Dorsey's band was playing. And you hear Tommy Dorsey playing "I'm Getting Sentimental Over You," his theme song. And Teagarden had never made it commercially like Tommy Dorsey. And so we were sitting there waiting to go on. He just picked up his trombone. When Tommy Dorsey played his theme song, he played it with him, and just the sound was so big it drowned out the whole huge speaker. I mean, that's just one small aspect of what he could do. He was tremendous.
And I believe you're verifying something which a lot of trombone players are. Matter of fact, let's talk to our musician friends. We have a lot of musicians who listen to these shows, and Teagarden, what he had done is learning the trombone at such a young age and of such short height at the time that he never really bothered with the sixth and seventh positions of the trombone, which call for full extension of the arm for a grown man, and that he discovered something that there were spaces in between the known seven positions where every few inches or so, the full cycle of tones available to you where you think you've got to go are available to you there. And having made that discovery, he perfected an embouchure that allowed him to play all of them in perfect tone. Pitch, I mean. His ear was unerring.
Yeah.
Sticking with the musical thing, while we were talking about the tenors, I should have asked you while I was asking you about Lester Young's timbre, is that now there seems to be a preference for a con tenor saxophone if you want to play in that kind of sound on tenor, and a Selmer or another horn if you want to play with the more huskier Hawkins school sound. What are your reflections on that?
I disagree. It's very personal. The con 10M, that's the only con. The con Conqueror was no good. The 10M Conqueror, which Lester Young used, was made of softer brass than a Selmer. In the Selmer, the molecules are pounded whereas to shape them, whereas in a con 10M, they were poured into a mold, so therefore the molecules are far apart. So it gives that opener, looser sound. It didn't have the tight fist sound of a Selmer. And I don't think, I'm sure Prez it was great, but I've heard 10Ms being played without that sound. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it's the saxophone. I think it's the idea in the man's head of the sound he wants to get, the mouthpiece, and the oral cavity.
While you were with these bands, we're speaking of Jack Teagarden and Benny Carter, new sounds were starting to come into jazz. Eventually they would be identified under the label bebop, but you could call it really a second generation of modern swing school or 52nd Street or bebop. You could call it anything you want, but it was different music was starting to happen. Do you recall any reflections on new concepts in jazz from either Teagarden or Goodman in talking to the band or to you or in their playing?
I don't understand what you're saying.
Well, you were with Jack Teagarden and Benny Goodman roughly over the years of 42, 43, 44. And during that period, that's when Dizzy is making his first statements with his own groups as a leader. The Eckstein Band comes out, the Cradle of Bebop wing in the Benny Carter Band, the Father Hines Band, Bird's first recordings with McShann, and at the end of that with the Tiny Grimes date are happening. Things are changing in jazz, things that you would clearly be able to make total use of, in fact, that it was, you made perfect sense in all the sense the places you played in. What about the older players who you worked for? What did they think of the scene, and did they reflect on it at all in your presence?
Oh, I think it was the same as when the Beatles came out. The older guys, their minds are closed. They wouldn't care for the Beatles, but the younger guys in the band, They immediately saw how amazing it was, and I got to hear Bird and Diz on 52nd Street while I was with Teagarden in 45. At that time, Benny Goodman was doing only army camps. We'd fly to them in an army plane 3-4 times a week, and the rest of the time I'd be on 52nd Street to hear this amazing music, and I was bowled over by it. And I don't think I tried to ape any of it. It just sort of, if you begin to love something, it's got to come into your playing, especially in your formative years.
We're talking with Stan Getz, and he's just offered an incredible chunk of information that while working infrequently with Benny Goodman and reprising his association with Jack Teagarden, he heard the tandem of Dizzy Gillespie and Charlie Parker in their first burst of glory on 52nd Street. Would that be the Three Deuces gig?
That's right.
Wow. Describe it in any other way you could, or what do you remember about it?
Well, I remember hearing Bird, and I wanted to get up and play with him, and he wouldn't let me. And I was going to listen to Errol Garner at the other club, the Spotlight, or wherever he was, and the only guy that would let me sit in was Beb Webster. You know how. And so I played on, finished the set, and I went back, and he come up to me and he said the exact words. He said, "We're nice eyes, Prez. Carry on." And to me, that was so gentlemanly and so nice. I'll never forget it. But another great man on the street was Errol Garner. Let me play with him. But you know, Bird and Diz were so wrapped up in this new music they were bringing out that they didn't have no time for a kid to sit in. God knows what they thought I might have done to their music. But it was a ball being there. I never heard him on record first. I heard him in person right at the beginning. Not at the beginning. The beginning was Minton's Uptown, a little earlier, I think.
Well, actually, I think Dizzy had tried to get Bird when he first brought Bebop to 52nd Street, and at the Onyx Club he had his first unit. You'll be surprised to find out what the personnel was on opening night. It was Dizzy on trumpet. The tenor saxophonist was Lester Young. The pianist was Thelonious Monk. The bassist was Dizzy's co-leader, Oscar Pettiford. And the drummer was a 19-year-old from Brooklyn who would be the drummer on your first record date as leader, named Max Roach.
How about that?
And I believe Prez immediately went back into the Basie band, and Monk and Dizzy always had their little conversations about not tempo, but time, if you get my drift. And, of course, eventually the pianist became George Wallington. And then a reformed quintet was brought to the Three Deuces, which is the band you saw, which, and in fact, because it was Diz and Bird, I think has to gain more currency in putting over this new music, which, of course, was the Three Deuces band with Al Haig on piano. Curly Russell probably was on bass when you were there. Was the drummer Max or Stan Levy?
Max was.
It was Max. All right. You caught it after Max had come in from the coast. He had left Benny Carter to rejoin Dizzy, of course. And was part of that group. You posed an interesting response in, when I asked you what maybe Teagarden and Goodman were thinking about. First of all, did Jack Teagarden or Benny Goodman, to your knowledge, come with you on any of these sojourns to 52nd Street, and did they hear any of this music?
No, it was before. I was with Teagarden before. Teagarden was the end of 42, beginning mm-hmm. of 43. And Goodman, no, he wasn't. Mm-hmm. He didn't come along, and I went alone, as a matter of fact. Right. 52nd.
We're talking with Stan Getz, and we're not alone. There are lots of people in the room, and we're having a little chat about jazz with some excellent musical examples to illustrate some of the points that we're making. This is Traditions in Swing. You're hearing it live on WKCR-FM New York, 89.9 on the dial. Our program solely devoted, of course, to this visit of Stan Getz on this Saturday evening. And Stan's here, and he's done us the extra favor of trying to remember things that are now nearing a half century ago in some instances. The Teagarden Band, soon the Benny Goodman Band, and of course his early visits to 52nd Street and some of the key players there. One question that I was going to toy with, probably we'll just talk about it for a second, but I'd be interested in your response. You know, you said, well, the older fellas had the same kind of reaction that people had later on, older fellas had later on, when the Beatles arrived. Well, you were a week past your 37th birthday when the Beatles first appeared on our American television on the Ed Sullivan Show, which would be roughly Benny Goodman's age at the same time that bebop hit 52nd Street. In fact, you were a bit older. What's your reaction to the Beatles?
To be perfectly honest with you, let me preface it by saying jazz musicians do not care about vocals. Mm-hmm. We're very hard on all vocalists and all singers. And when I first heard them, I thought they were very kindergarten. I didn't realize that the basic truths they were saying to the kids of their times, which still stand up, their truths. It took me a while, quite a while. Don't forget, I was always fighting. I was also fighting them on the charts. We had a record that knocked them off the charts. It was the only time the Beatles ever got knocked out of first place. And I wouldn't give in until afterward. And I said, these guys are saying something.
But it was more their message than any particularly witty kind of musical statement.
Well, no? Musically, for a jazz musician, I think what they do is very elementary, you know. Mm-hmm. And it has to be for a broader amount of people to understand their music. And that's the story of all rock and all folk music. It's simple. You know, and that's why people like it. But it's their message. Their message of hope to their generation was perfectly timed with what was happening in the generation.
A little bit later, after their first burst of glory, you ended up working, if I'm not mistaken, with their producer, who is actually a classical musician turned recording engineer named George Martin.
That's right.
That was the Dynasty album?
Right.
Yeah. Any reflections or memories of that?
Nothing much, except my father died during the making of the record, and I flew across the ocean. It was made in London,
yeah,
to his funeral, and then went back and put a song on there called Ballad for My Dad.
Right.
Just as my mother had died during the making of Focus, and the tune Her on Focus, I was thinking about her.
Well, we're thinking about Stan Getz. He's here with us and doing wonderful things and just telling stories of jazz for us here on WKCR-FM New York, 89.9 on the dial. The other half of the early days question, could you tell us about the Benny Goodman scene and playing with him and what you recall?
Great musician, Benny Goodman. His conception of sound was very superior. There wasn't one horn player in all the 14 horns that had a bad sound. To get into his band, you had to have the good sound. And that was a joy to play in the saxophone section that really clicked on all cylinders. Another thing, he used to rehearse the band without the rhythm section to see who really could swing without a rhythm section. And I thought that was great. Benny was a great leader, a very centered man who didn't care as if we were on a radio broadcast. Say the Coca-Cola spotlight broadcast where it's coast to coast from army camps, right? And the man says, and now Benny Goodman, well, there's no such thing as dead air time. You do not have dead air time. It's a no-no. Well, he'd be thinking of the tempo for the tune And even though he knew he was supposed to go into it, he would not beat it off until he had the right tempo, which could be a minute or a minute and a half. He's a very dedicated man to his music, Benny Goodman.
Right. Stan Getz on the topic of Benny Goodman. Well, if Benny Goodman, by the way, for some of our listeners should be known as sometimes known for giving musicians a hard time, and I'm about to give Stan Getz a hard time. He's my guest here today, so I must be an evil fellow. I've got a mystery here that I've been dying to ask you about for a number of years. One of the things, just to make this contemporary, at the end of the sad day of Roy Eldridge's funeral, which was Wednesday, 3 days ago, people were being encouraged by names we could just say aloud, just let them ring out and say that they were players still on the scene and still alive. You just say it out loud and you just felt a whole lot better about the thing. Like, for instance, Stan Getz is going to be at the station Saturday evening. And all of a sudden that made people smile more than just the anticipation of your visit. Wow, yeah, Stan, yeah, great. And then another person pointed out Lionel Hampton, for instance, and Benny Carter is, let's say, the seniors of the...
Wait a minute. Let me cut in.
Okay.
Friday last week, 8 days ago, I played a benefit for the Lionel Hampton Music School, which is at the University of Idaho. Okay. Trudging through snow to play this benefit. And Lionel was there, Ray Brown was there, a lot of people. He brought a Russian saxophonist and piano player. And at the end of every set, Lionel would come up and thank the men for coming, and then he'd insist. Well, he didn't insist, he just started to play with them. For every set, including mine, that man came up and played. I never saw an 80-year-old man with that much joie de vivre.
Right.
So go ahead. It's funny you mentioned that.
One of the exciting studio situations that Norman Granz, I presume Norman Granz, correct me if I'm wrong, put you in during those years of the JATP years was an album that you did probably in a hurry. It's just one record date, August 1st, 1955, with you and Lionel Hampton, the now thankfully re-released recording of called Hamp and Getz. One of the things I do when I present this on the air is point out that a lot of people are surprised to find out there's a Hamp and Getz album, and a further surprise when they find out how many years ago it was. It's going to be 34 years this summer, and I tell them, well, the best surprise is how wonderful the music is, and I put it on. I usually blow them out with Jumping at the Woodside. It's the first track. I do restoration work. In fact, it's really probably how I pay the rent, which is, you know, fixing... Broken disc was my first specialty, you know, the old stuff, the 16 inches that you made your first recordings on. In fact, I fixed your first record date, the 16 inches, with the Savoy date. Lubinsky didn't throw out the originals, but he kept them in a hot room, and they got waterlogged. And so anyway, I fixed it anyway, so there's something I did for the music, which, without
that.
Playing a note. But a very, very misfiled, corroded box of tape was all that really remained in the holdings of Verve Records for this outing of Hamp and Getz. And it didn't really say Hamp and Getz on it. It didn't say anything. It was just a box that I was supposed to fix. And it took a long time because little splicing tapes had oozed onto it. And once, if you sprung it, I'm talking musically, you know, the oxide will bounce off the tape and the sound will be gone. So it was a very long, loving, hand cleaned, you know, a little dash of chemical here and there. In any case, when I got it back together again, I find a tune on it, which they say the name of it is Headache. And I called Lionel Hampton, and he said, well, I don't remember writing a tune called Headache. And no one really knows where this headache comes from. But one thing that I noticed when I was playing it, it's from the same date and is, in fact, on the new version of it, Hamp and Getz, which is on the CD version. On Verve 831672-2. Any case, it's on this, is that there's another horn player there. And I can't, you know, all of a sudden, at the end of this date, there's another horn player. And one thing that's...
Trombone?
It might be a trombone. It might be your man, Mr. Brookmeyer. Then again, it occurs to me it might be the French horn of Willie Ruff, who was with the Hampton Band at the time. And I'm in a doubt whether it's a French horn or a trombone, or whether perhaps this player might have written this tune, Headache, which has you, of course, on tenor saxophone and Lionel Hampton.
You sure it's me on it?
Well, I'll go 0 for 2, or 2 for 2 if I'm right, rather. You don't have any recollection of this headache. Well, we'll take two Ashmans and play it for you.
Unless I've lost my mind, there was no French horn or trombone in that studio when I did my original 12-inch recording with Lionel. They might have slapped something on the CD, but no.
Well, we'll see what it plays
like. Let's hear it.
Okay. By the way, if you just tuned in, you're listening to the sounds of jazz over the airways of radio station WKCR-FM New York, 89.9 on the dial. This is a very special evening, and I tell you, we really needed a visit like this at this end of a sad week. And thank you so much for coming. Stan Getz is here. Our program is fun, which is jazz, but it's also a little bit more than fun. There's some serious information, some great music being heard and felt, and we're very pleased to be visited by Stan Getz. I'm Phil Schaap. This is WKCR-FM New York, and I hope this music doesn't upset you. I wouldn't want you to trade a headache for an upset stomach.
No, the reason I say that, is because I love Willie Ruff's playing, and I'd have remembered.
Okay, well, I'll play it for you. Thank you. Well, I don't know if that will end the headache, but it certainly was interesting listening, and a very swinging affair. That's from the session of August 1st, 55, that produced the album Hamp and Getz, but it's an extra track there, and I'm wondering what you think about it. Stan Getz.
Well, I think I'm going to have to take the fifth on that, because I remember no trombone player, and you're right, it does sound like a French horn player, a very good French horn player, and it's probably Willie Ruff, but Hamp doesn't remember it. I don't remember it, so you got me, buddy.
Okay, well, there's a recording that has surfaced.
I wonder if they had overdubbing equipment then where...
They did, but they almost always during that period would only use overdubbing for a very severe and central purpose. In other words, record the band and then have the vocalists come in later with the band pre-recorded, or in a couple of instances when they wanted to have Louis Armstrong play obbligato behind his own vocal. There's an instance of it in jazz that way. Clearly overdubbing existed, but there wasn't multi-track. That didn't exist.
No,
and
I know that, but
it's an awful lot of trouble to put an off-mic French horn player in for one chorus and then to have him off-mic in the out choruses.
Nobody did play a short solo.
Yeah, but the only...
Which could have been a piano solo, and he's playing over it. Well, no, it couldn't have been. That's Lou Levy on piano. I'm afraid we're not going to be able to put it to rest. You'll have to
I got Willie Ruff to go
further.
Yes, well, two headliners. Now move on to the rhythm section and to Willie Ruff, I think, is my next real stop. Yeah. Because he was at that time playing French horn with
the
Lionel Hampton Man.
I'll ask Lou Levy when I see him.
All right. We're talking with Stan Getz, and we're having a ball here on a Saturday evening's Traditions in Swing. Phil Schaap here, and this is a live interview. Stan Getz has most graciously consented to visit the station. He's got the only decent chair in the joint. Even that one's all taped up. But one thing that we do keep here that is in good condition is the music, and we're playing jazz music. And, of course, there are so many different things that you can play with Stan Getz on it, from the early big band experiences to, of course, some of the monumental solos that introduced him to a wider audience. Small group record dates that were spinoffs from the Woody Herman period. And I guess it wouldn't be fair to either our listeners, particularly the old-time listeners, and having done the Tea Garden and the Benny Goodman thing, is not to ask you about the Woody Herman years. And in particular, can I ask you about the difference between how you felt and what you played? It may be a question you can just say, I can't answer that, and that would be understandable. When you were literally recording Summer Sequence, and there's a fourth part of it where you came forward with such a wonderful solo for the fourth movement, of course, of the Summer Sequence, is Early Autumn. That was a Columbia recording, and a brilliant one, of course, a masterpiece. Then a few years later, there you are, still with Woody Herman's band, and Early Autumn is now so popular, primarily because of your solo, that it's now become its own tune. In fact, Johnny Mercer would later write lyrics to Early Autumn, and in fact, Woody sings them on a third version in the 50s. Now Early Autumn's its own tune, and you come forward with another solo. The opportunity to quote yourself completely must have presented itself, but to touch the old solo and to make a new masterpiece was the greater challenge, and one you answered. Could you talk about the two recordings?
Far as I know, far as I feel, at this moment, it was the same as then, it was just another recording. The fourth movement of
Summer
Sequence was just something tossed in front of us, an afterthought by Ralph Burns, who wrote it. And we played the date, and it was a solo on my part, and I played it. And then it was never released for a while. And then Early Autumn was another record date, and I think Ralph designated that he wanted me to have the solo on that. So I played that, and it's just a record date. So there are no visions of grandeur.
How about in Hein Here? What do you think of your solos on the Columbia recording of Summer Sequence with Early Autumn Incorporated and the Capitol recordings?
You know, I've heard the Summer Sequence solo maybe three times in my whole life, because I don't possess my own records. I don't remember what I played on it. Early Autumn I've heard because it's played on the radio enough for me to hear it. And it's okay. It's a nice solo. But I don't get it. I don't understand why it was such an earth-shaking thing. It's just another ballad solo for me. I did a computer concerto, computer music concerto at Stanford, written by Dexter Morrill, who was the professor of computer music. I did it at Stanford, and he did a whole concerto based on that solo. I mean, I don't get it. I just don't understand those things. My music is something that's done and forgotten about.
Perhaps a different way of answering the question for the only person who doesn't understand it, who of course is the man who created it, Stan Getz, who you're listening to, by the way, live on this radio show, is to say that didn't you have solos that were played by people such as Lester Young, who probably would have said it was just the chorus I blew in the studio?
Oh, when I'm sure.
And yet we know that those are masterpieces, and you felt the same way about someone else's chorus.
Oh, definitely. It's just, it's no big deal as far as I'm concerned.
Well, it's somehow...
And that's not false modesty, I promise you.
I believe it.
You know, when you play a solo, you always listen to it, and afterwards you say you could have played it better. So we just play it and go on to the next thing.
Well, perhaps there's something to it in this, the fact that in the big band years, there were things to set off the soloist. Now, most saxophone players, indeed most horn players I've encountered in life, always say what Lester Young would have said, or have said in his later years, that happiness was the Mills Brothers, in other words, you and your rhythm section. Nevertheless, there are certain things that set off solos that left them so much the more striking because they were coming out of focused music, arranged music, and seemed to add an impact to the listener, which didn't mean that the solo was any more than it would have been if it had been stripped bare and it was just the rhythm section and the horn player, but somehow it's just devastating. I mean, the Basie band obviously knew that completely, and not just for setting off Lester Young solos. Is that something you feel, that the big bands and arrangements help set off solos?
Of course. A big band is a best way. It's just a wonderful community effort, you know. And you don't think of yourself, you think of the whole band. You only get a little bit to say on a big band solo. And we just wanted to make the whole record sound good. But that approach to music has stayed with me through all the quartet years. Whereas every musician in a quartet has to be a fine soloist, because I don't play just to be out front. I play to listen to other good soloists play. Like right now it's Kenny Barron playing piano and whoever is playing with the band. It's just one community effort, because if I were to go on concerts and be the front man and not care what else is on it, I get awful bored. Mm-hmm. I go to work every night wanting to hear other people's conception of music. And that's why I've had some good quartets, because I don't want to get bored. I'll lose it. And if you lose it, you blow it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not going to lose the opportunity to keep asking Stan Getz questions here on a Saturday evening visit. I'm Phil Schaap. This is happening live. The program is on WKCR-FM New York. This program is called Traditions in Swing, and to have Stan Getz here is to have swing. There's an essence of rhythm continuum that's in this music, and if it isn't there, it really doesn't matter what style or what generation it's from. And indeed, you even heard Stan Getz himself say, well, there's that Dixieland thing that he got with Jack Teagarden, and he's added so many different pieces to the musical puzzle, but it's always swung. And
it's just like language. You learn the alphabet, which are the scales. You learn sentences, which are the chords. And then you speak extemporaneously. And it's a wonderful thing to be able to speak extemporaneously, which is something I've never gotten. But musically, I love to talk just off the top of my head, and that's what jazz music's all about.
Talking with Stan Getz, perhaps you could speak extemporaneously on the topic of a bass player who is also something of a composer and who is much better known for having worked with Bill Evans, but he worked with you. And I'm speaking of Scotty LaFaro, who died shortly after playing a last gig with you at the Newport Festival.
He was on my band when he died.
Yeah.
And he was given a piece of land by his mother, and so he bowed out of playing the next week with us, and we used Henry Grimes, and he drove up there, maybe a good 500, 600, 700 miles, whatever it was, from Newport to Lake Saranac, I think was it.
Geneva, New York,
New York. I was playing at Saranac or something. And he was killed in an accident, you know, and he wasn't a good driver, because the night at Newport, he drove my 30-year-old daughter and I to the job, and he was a wreck as a driver. Uh-huh. He just could not a good driver. And she was 3 years old at the time, and she was frightened the way he drove. Anyway, he was an exceptional talent, one of the first of that school of bass players to raise the level of bass playing from just accompanying to soloing. And it was a terrible loss. I drove to his funeral. We took off that night, and Steve Kuhn and I went to his funeral up in Geneva. Terrible. That's it. What about Brownie, Clifford Brown?
Oh, my word, yes.
Killed on the Pennsylvania tour. I wonder what he'd been playing now if he was alive.
That's an interesting thought. Clearly, one of the challenges to Brownie, this is speaking in terms of brass, is that, you know, that's one of the more athletic of instruments, that trumpet players start to lose their range and their flexibility in the upper register. But he was such a musical person that I think that now, if Brownie were alive now, he would not yet, of course, be 60, so he might not even be losing any range anyway. But he would have come up with ideas to balance whatever absence of technique hit him as he got older, I think.
I think you're right. He drank milk and ate fried chicken. I never seen him dissipate in any way. He'd have been right on it because he was a clean living, beautiful man.
Back to Scott LaFaro for one second. First of all, am I correct that he preferred Scotty as opposed to Scott, or didn't it make any difference to him?
I don't know his preference.
Uh-huh. Did he in any way address the fact that in the same sequence, in the spring of 1961, he's playing in this unique trio with Bill Evans, where there's a great deal more interplay between the piano, and isn't a piano-led trio in the sense that we had known it up to that point. There's this interplay, so there's that going on. Then he's playing with your quartet, and of course that represents a lot of different things to people's ears, but it was a very dynamic quartet that was able to play the new musics of jazz as well as the real jazz, which, you know, you were playing your music and whatever came out was right and proper. And then there was what people really were calling the new jazz at the time. He was working with Ornette Coleman. Did he converse with you about this in any way, shape, or form at that time, that he was playing all these gigs at the same time?
Didn't know. I don't remember talking about it.
Mm-hmm. Well, now we're talking with Stan Getz, and get the opportunity to be fairer. Would you like to introduce a topic? What would you like to talk about? Stan Getz.
I would like to thank Reverend John Gensel for what he's become to the jazz community. It's brought us all closer together in times of crisis. And I think having a ministry of jazz is a wonderful thing. We can all go to congregate and to commiserate and to be happy at different times. And I'd like to salute him. He's a great man.
I second that emotion. Reverend John Garcia Gensel, who is, of course, a man who's been on the scene many years. Just to show you, it's not just jazz. He was ordained May 15th, 1943. He just celebrated his birthday on the 16th of February, so his same month as you and the same sign.
Same day as my mother's birthday.
Oh, yes. Yeah. He turned 72.
Anyway, I've had some medical problems as of late, and he has called me numerous times and saying that his congregation is praying for me. And I swear to God, it works.
Well, the wishes of his congregations for you are announced at the end of each of the Jazz Vespers services. I can assure you that that is very much the case. And
yeah.
If it's doing good, we're going to keep on doing it.
Please, don't stop now. Could we?
We have the
12-minute track. I can't get started.
That's what we're... First of all... We're talking about, of course, Stan Getz's forthcoming release, and as long as we're doing it upright, why don't you say what the release is going to be and help people find it once it comes out. This is Stan Getz's new album.
We don't know much about it, except it's going to be released.
Uh-huh. It's a live recording. Can you tell me anything else?
It's recorded at Café Montmartre on a tour in July. It was July 6, 1987. It was just another night, because I don't believe in